full house again. This is great. Mea culpa to start out with. Last week I indicated that we would have a couple of guests to visit with us, and that was my error. We do not. Unfortunately, I'm going to have to suffer through PowerPoint purgatory, my droning for another full 2 hours. Again, please ask a question as soon as it comes into your head, and we will try and answer it. And again, we are videotaping, so if you have a question, if you could be sure to raise your voice so that it gets on the audio track, that would be pretty helpful. I'll try to repeat them as well so that we have the continuity. Tonight we're talking about, in the beginning basically, the very first stages of what would happen as a grower, and that it has to do with where the babies come from. It's sort of the 5 or 6 year old question, asking mommy. And then secondly, when you get your seed and you begin the process, what are the steps that you need to know in order to safely handle them and to get down the road to a successful project? So last time we talked about an overview. We had looked at why we're doing it and why, what the benefits and the trade-offs were, the cons and the pros, what your expectations should be as a farmer, something called best management practices, which is the manual of what to do and what not to do in terms of all of the different aspects of operations. And then we started out with biology of the shellfish and a brief overview of how they work and what makes them tick. We're sort of going to continue with that now in terms of making sure that you understand what a hatchery is. And a hatchery is basically a factory, for lack of a better term. We're going to ask what they are, why do we need them? Why would you want a shellfish factory? How they work, what the issues are with them, and the things that you want to know about a hatchery so that you're a better informed consumer, because you're going to be buying stuff from a hatchery or a nursery. Finding your seed supplier, and then, good question, why would you care about all of this stuff? It's just like thinking about how the General Motors research division did something about their emission controls. It's not quite that specific, but you do need to know the background on this so that you, again, are a better informed grower. So, seed generally comes from hatcheries. Almost all of it, and by saying almost, I mean probably 90 and a better percent, comes from a hatchery at some point. And typically that's going to be a local area. The second option for you might be to purchase your seed from a nursery, which is the next level up in the development of the babies to get to be adults. And nursery sounds, you know, it is exactly what it sounds like. It's taking care of the babies and getting them up to adolescence, if you will. They, in turn, most, get their seed from a hatchery, or they have their own hatchery. So there are some facilities that have both nursery areas and hatchery areas. There are some businesses that just operate it as a nursery. They don't go beyond that. And then, of course, the growers are going to bring the stuff to market. There is wild seed available. Obviously, Mother Nature does provide some seed, because otherwise we wouldn't have any shellfish left. And on occasion, it will be in very, very large quantities in a particular area. The problem that we have, however, is we never know where that's going to happen or when. So as a grower or harvester of that seed, it's a wide open field. And if you're going to have your business plan work on something that may or may not happen at this particular location at this particular time, not a very good business plan. Sometimes oysters are captured that way. And a typical example of that would be the town of Wellfleet, which has a very, very large standing crop of population of oysters, and frequently there will be heavy sets And as a result, the babies will show up. And kind of unique to the town of Wellfleet, the harvest of seed for aquaculture purposes is permitted on a limited basis. Softshell clams will sometimes show up on a site, and depending on the town and the regulations, they can be harvested and thinned and used in an aquaculture project. But perhaps mussels are the most common species that would be used for wild capture of seed. And again, it would be an area where consistently there is a good set, and there's an opportunity to take advantage of that with some kind of a capture thing that would then allow the grower to maintain and intervene in their growth and bring them to market size. So what is a shellfish hatchery? Well, last week we said that farming is defined by the FAO as an intervention. So you're intervening somehow in the natural process in order to help secure safe passage for these babies up to adulthood. And it gives in some kind of an artificial manipulation of conditions resulting in controlled spawning and the rearing of juvenile shellfish. So basically, it's a factory. So we're setting up an area where we're going to pretend we're Mother Nature, and we're going to take some adults and make them think that all is well and it must be summer, and so it's time to spawn. Most of the work that was done in the early 20th century, starting in about 1920 and running up through the 60s and 70s, was done by government agencies and institutional research, universities in particular, trying to figure out what was the best way, the most optimal method of getting shellfish seed on a regular, consistent basis from adults. There are right now a variety of mixes. There is a couple of companies that are privately held and corporations. There are educational facilities that are producing seed both on a limited basis and an experimental basis, limited for the commercial market. And public agencies. So that would include things like when Eastham had its hatchery running, there was a hatchery that we didn't produce seed for sale, but we produced it for other towns and for the town of Eastham. Mass Maritime Academy had a hatchery that was distributing seed also. Same thing, largely for town use. And again, the reason we have to have them is because the amount of seed that shows up every year annually is unpredictable. If, again, we go to the public trust doctrine, and if five or six growers went out and harvested all of the seed that was in Wellfleet Harbor, then it wouldn't do very well for the capture fishery. So this public trust doctrine thing is going to kick in again. The reliability of a hatchery in a perfect world would be something that everybody could bank on. They're not 100% reliable. Even the best of the hatcheries have good years and bad years. But in general, it's a far more realistic expectation that if you put an order in for seed, you will get seed. And in maybe not all of the seed that you wanted, and maybe not size or the timing or something like that, but seed will be more available, and it sure beats going down the beach and waiting for Mother Nature to dump a load of seed in your pocket. Many of the hatcheries are also looking at how can we do this better, faster, cheaper. And that goes in terms of disease resistance as well, because there are diseases of shellfish, and breeding strains that are more resistant to a particular disease is in everybody's best interest. And there's a fair amount of research money that's available through National Fisheries Service, and that's distributed to both National Fisheries Service labs and educational institutions to do that kind of work. The one other thing that was characteristic of quahogs in particular during the 70s and 80s was to create the Notata strain, or not create it, but to amplify the Notata strain, which has this rather unique marking on the outside of the shell. And characterized that seed as hatchery raised. It occurs naturally in the wild in about 0.1% of the population. But what the hatcheries were doing was using those brightly colored animals as their broodstock through successive generations. And good old Mendel and his laws of genetics predicted that the more adults that you had with that characteristic in the gene pool, and the fewer that were plain Jane kind of markings, then the more you would expect in the succeeding generations. And that was working quite well for a number of years. They were also marketed as the jewels of the sea, and get a little extra money because they look nice on a plate of pasta or something. Some serious questions came up, however, about what other characteristics would be riding in that gene pool that were hidden time bombs. Disease resistance, shelf life, taste, something like that. So many of the hatcheries have sort of backed away from that and try and keep a much wider gene pool going so that we don't end up with 25 generations down the road, all of a sudden a dead end and nothing grows and nobody can sell their product. I'm not sure why waving my hand at this is working, but it is. We have to consider the fact that in nature, the odds of fertilization and successful development of babies is pretty slim. It's like the oak tree. Thousands of acorns come down out of an oak tree, but you don't have thousands of oak trees growing around the big old oak. You may have one, maybe two. dandelion seeds, lots of other seeds that are produced by plants. Millions of seeds go out. One or two of them will actually make it. And same thing with most direct spawning marine species, shellfish are part of that. Large quantities of eggs are produced by an animal, typically 10, 15, 20 million eggs out of an adult oyster. That's a lot of eggs. And the other technique that has evolved over the millions of years is that where the sexes are separate and everybody's in this big pile of shellfish, having a female spawn today, the tide carries the eggs off, and having a male decide tomorrow's the day I'm going to spawn, I'm not really going to spawn today, it's hopeless, and that egg is never going to be fertilized. So they all spawn at the same time, and that increases the odds dramatically. And then typically everybody is, all of the shellfish are going to spawn roughly in the same week or two during the summer. That's based on the fact that they're getting enough food, the temperature is rising, we said they're all cold-blooded animals, they need to have warmth, and summer is generally the time that it's going to happen. If 20 million eggs are spawned in nature, and two of those actually reach adulthood, then the species is successful. So 2 out of 20 million, do the math, it's not good. That doesn't always happen. So from an individual animal, maybe 10 actually reach it to maturity, and another animal, 0. So it levels out, and of course there's good years and bad years. So we have a big scallop here. Well, it was probably a little better than 20 million to one odds. But there are other years when you walk the flats and you don't see a single softshell clam or any other species. It wasn't a good year. So this is some graphics that show what happens. These kinds of spawning efforts are eggs or sperm. And we draw the comparison with the dandelion and all of the seeds that are just blasting off. Not exactly the same situation, because the dandelion seeds aren't going to be fertilized. They were fertilized earlier when the bee walked by or some other insect. And again, we're talking about very, very sophisticated, state-of-the-art, high-tech, multi-million dollar facilities. No, they're not quite that. They are basic. They are working with seawater. They are baling wire and chewing gum to a large degree. Some of the equipment is pretty sophisticated, pretty expensive, but this is in Dennis. It's the Aquaculture Research Corporation. It is not exactly a palace, but they do produce seed on a regular basis. They're good at it, and they know what they're doing through years of experience. Some of these buildings have probably been around since the 20s or 30s. We have these big tanks, sort of like the one that we showed you last week, with lights. The overview is basically, as I said before, we're replicating nature. We have control conditions. And by that, we know what the temperature is, we know what the salinity is, the critical things. Yes, sir?
Yeah, the the hatchery you just showed in Dennis?
Yes.
They were going around from town to town trying to get money to be expanded, basically selling the property and asking to be, you know, rented it back.
Yes.
Hoping that they would get, you know, enlarge their facility so that they could actually supply the quantities of seed everybody wants. Do you know what happened with that, or?
Well, yes, and that has been an ongoing project for a number of years, and it's still ongoing. Has not yet been resolved. And there's lots and lots of parts and pieces to it. We could probably spend 2 hours talking about that.
Because I saw them come to the town, you
yes.
know, my town, and but it comes to a later question. It seems like seed is hard to come by, actually.
Aquaculture Research Corp is the only functioning supplier of seed on Cape Cod, physically located on Cape Cod at this time. How many growers? We saw the graph of how many growers are on Cape Cod. It is an issue. They have been consistently very productive in terms of supplying seed to as many of their customers as they can, but it's a big concern. There are other commercially available hatcheries along the coast of Rhode Island, Connecticut, Long Island Sound, up through the coast of Maine. We're talking a handful, however. No, actually, I think the last count was 20. So there are other hatcheries that are producing seed. So it's not just this one here, but this is certainly centrally located, and it provides an awful lot of the seed for the Cape growers.
Yeah. So I'm sure you're going to get to it, but how hard is it to get seed that you know, is there waiting lists on most of them, or can you just?
Typically not. I'm not familiar with you know, unless it's a really bad year, and that does happen, where an entire one or two spawns of shellfish will be lost, and everybody then has to take a smaller amount, or first come, first serve kind of thing.
Also, you get smaller, right? Like, there's usually, you can get the smallest.
Well, you could get smaller size. You could also get fewer animals. Again, depending on the timing of when, if there is a failure, when it happened, because hatcheries will typically gear up right after Christmas and start their process, so they actually have seed available through the course of the summer, or spring, and into summer. And we'll talk about perhaps getting last year's spawn, which would be much bigger, early in the spring, but it's actually a year old. It's not that year's spawn. So there's options. And generally speaking, once you establish a rapport with a supplier, they're going to understand that you're a customer. It's a business proposition, and one hand shakes the other. So we have control conditions. We instead of that 2 out of 20 million eggs being fertilized and surviving, it goes up, not dramatically, but it does go up. Nowhere near 100%, probably less than 25 or 30% on average. And it is somewhat less subject to the forces of nature. In other words, cold weather like this really doesn't matter inside a building where the heater is running. It means the fuel bill is going to be higher, but it's not going to affect the spawning and the production of the larvae. The methods are basically, in order to replicate nature, we have to produce food, because typically in nature the food doesn't show up until it's a lot warmer in the season. But as I said, if we're starting in December or January, we need to get the food going early. We need to find the broodstock and make sure that they're warming and fed well. Then there's the spawning process itself. And then as the eggs are fertilized and developed through their development of a larval stage, they then change from swimming around to stuck to the bottom or digging or something like that. And then once they're done that, there's a period of time when they need still more TLC until they're big enough to actually go out into the wild, which is where the grower is going to be working with them. Food up here, again, we said it's algae. It's just plain old green stuff. It just looks like green water that you'd find in the harbor. It's a little bit more sophisticated than that, because these are single-cell cultures. So there's one kind of algae growing in this tank. It's that particular color. There's a different one in that tank. There's a different one in that tank. Each one of them has a slightly different characteristic in terms of its carbohydrate content, for instance, or its lipids, Some are better for early stage, some are better for late stage. Again, this is the research that's been done over the last 50 years in the institutions and marine fisheries to gauge optimum growth based on this particular species or a mix of species for this particular scallop, for instance, and at this particular stage in its life. And then we have a spawning event, and we end up with juveniles. These are 1 millimeter squares, no, 100 micron squares, so that would be a full, probably about 200 microns. So we're talking microscopic here. They then go into tanks, and they swim around there for a while during their development stage. And starting out with the algae part, what do we need? Well, it's a plant, so it needs all the things that plants need. It needs sunlight, it needs a seed, something to start it with. In other words, either a seedling, if you were doing your garden, or a seed itself. It needs fertilizer, it needs nitrogen in particular, phosphorus, a whole bunch of other trace elements. It needs air, and it needs clean water. These are all marine species. Clean meaning no other weeds. So a lot of filtration goes on to make sure that the weeds don't overtake that one species that you're trying to go, that's a unicellular good guy. Just like any other kind of a garden or any other farming, you want to make sure that you've got a pure culture. And that's what they look like. The seed cultures are in little tiny flasks, again, different colors. Looks pretty sterile. It is pretty sterile. They get flamed. They have stoppers to make sure that the air doesn't infiltrate, because believe it or not, there are species of weeds that are airborne, and they will just float right into the, especially if you're around the shoreline, they'll float, drop into that culture, and then when you start to grow it big time, you've grown the weed as well, and you basically have to throw the whole culture away. They graduate from the Erlenmeyer flask to bigger Erlenmeyer flasks. And typically, the method is to add some of the seeds to filtered water, clean water, some nutrients, stand back, and in about a week, it will reach the density that the seed was at. Typically, a couple, 3 million cells per mil. We're talking tiny, tiny cells. When that happens, again, it's divided typically into a gallon container. If that looks like a gallon jug for wine, that's exactly what it is. We recycle. The wine has to go somewhere, so. But then, when that is about a week later, that will be fully developed. It'll be as green as it's going to get. It goes into a 5-gallon carboy. Another week later, that 5-gallon carboy goes into a 30-gallon tube. And again, you'll see covers on the top, air lines bubbling all around. Bubbling is mostly to get the algae out near the light all the time so that it'll grow fast. These cells divide very, very quickly. And again, the whole thing has to happen in a warm environment. It can't be frigid cold, because they won't grow as quickly as if it were around 20 degrees centigrade. Yeah?
I got a question. So we get a series of hatcheries, and we get a process. Who owns the gold standard for process optimization in the industry?
There is none.
So there's no TQM, there's no Six Sigma, no way, like, light years from that.
Light years is a good example, yes.
Because of the variability.
Yes. Yep.
Because the input is so variable.
And it's highly specific to the environment. So
you have no Bureau of Standards with respect to, you know, like if I set up a millipore bench, I know that millipore is going to be the same as barrows according to some standard.
Correct.
None of that work has been done here.
No. And it's largely intuition, experience. Certainly, the federal labs have done a ton of work. They have produced numerous papers on optimal conditions for their applications. In other words, the nutrient supplement that's used for the fertilizer has been very well established. And so the balance between the various nitrogen, phosphate, and everything else, that's pretty much a standard. And the timing is pretty consistent, but it could be 8 days instead of 7 days. And if things cool down, it could be 10 days. Yeah. So that's why human intervention is a very important part.
So basically, there's so much variability because everybody's changing their perception of what the optimum is, because they're under the duress of profitability.
That's correct, yeah. So, the broodstock, these are the mommies and daddies that are going to be producing the eggs, need to be selected for fast growth. In other words, you can, if you pick up an animal that only has two or three growth rings on it, and it's already 4 inches long, you know that guy's grown very, very quickly. That's the kind of broodstock that you want to have in the succeeding generations. If you find one that's still 2 inches at 10 years out, then that's probably not going to be a fast grower. So that's not going to do well in the hatchery situation. Disease resistance is a big problem, more so for oysters than for many other diseases, for many other species rather. And over the period of 30 years, that the one particular disease that's been most dramatically impacting the fishery and the product, there has been a great deal of selection for the most resistant out of a brood, using them for the subsequent brood stock. Obviously, the ones that died are not going to do too well spawning, but generally speaking, the ones that are the healthiest, the most robust, are going to be selected out for the future generations. What does the shell look like? Question?
Yeah. Could you just touch on, I know we're going to talk about it later, but disease?
Disease, yeah.
Which diseases are we worried about?
A lot of them. I don't want to scare you, but there's an entire evening on diseases. Yeah. Oysters, quahogs, clams, yeah. And we have diseases that affect the shellfish. We have diseases that affect the people that eat the shellfish. So, yeah. It's a wild world out there.
Yeah.
I'm going to ease you into that, gentlemen. By the same token, we still have to have this wide genetic pool so that we don't end up with this issue of 10, 15 years from now finding out that, oops, we shouldn't have selected that particular size oyster just because it was that particular size. We needed to have some other things that go with it, because now we're at the end of the line, got to start all over again. The fact that animals only spawn once a year, and there's only one opportunity to get successful spawning, typically in the late winter, early spring, means if you have a failure, you're going to wait till next year. And it's just like any other agricultural crop. If the corn goes south in July, farmer is not going to be able to replant and get another product in that season, in our area. Certainly in Florida, places where it's not seasonal, that's a different story. But for what we're talking about, polyploidy is the development of triploids and other species which have a characteristic of very, very fast growth, but they're sterile for the most part. And there's a lot of work been done with that to try and accelerate the rate of growth from the seed stage to the market by specifically engineering, rather than diploids, going to triploids and tetraploids. That's kind of on the margins and not a continuous, well, there's a couple of growers that are mostly working with them. So we need to condition the shellfish to get the seed going on the earlier growing season. Again, the earlier the seed makes it into your farm, the faster it's going to grow through the summer, the bigger it's going to be going into the winter. And the winter is not an easy time for anything that's cold-blooded living out there. So the bigger is better when it gets to September, October, November, which then you backtrack. If you can get started earlier and it's going to be faster growing, then you'll have a better harvest. You'll have an earlier harvest. So we produce lots of heated water and food during this time of year, in the spring, late winter, early spring. And most of them are pretty low-tech methods of heating. We stick a heating, like an aquarium heating unit, into a tank of water, or an oil-fired burner if you're trying to heat up a ton of water and a lot of animals. Again, it's not particularly super critical, but generally speaking, the water is raised 1 degree per day or every other day for a period of several weeks, so you're not shocking the animals. They're coming out of maybe 32-degree water, 33-degree water, and they need to be up to 70-degree water in order to spawn. So that has to happen over a period of 5, 6, 7 weeks. then that food that we've been growing, again, has to be added to the tank where these oysters are being conditioned on a regular basis. And because they're cold-blooded animals, they don't need too much first few weeks, couple of days, because they're not active. But as you change the temperature, you also need to ramp up the amount of food that they're eating and the kind of food. In other words, more lipids, more carbs, depending on the species. And at the end of that 6 to 8 week time, they're gonna think that it's now the 4th of July weekend and it's time to spawn, when it's really the end of March. They don't do the calendar too well, but that's okay. It's an example of base golf. It's in a big table, water circulating around, could be flow through with a heater, could be recirculating with a filter. They will get food on a regular basis, and as the temperature goes up, they will continue to develop their gonadal material. Last week we talked about the physiology of the shellfish and said that about 50% of the mass of the internal parts of the shellfish are just gonads. And this is a good example of a shellfish that is not ready to spawn and then one that is. And the color of the eggs is very characteristic when they're ready to spawn. And again, the only way to find that out is, unfortunately, to sacrifice the animal. It's the easiest way to find out. Again, so one that has already spawned or is not ready is going to be kind of watery looking, and the one that's ready to spawn will have a milky appearance or an orange appearance, depending on whether it's eggs or sperm. Interestingly enough, with the bay scallop, this is a sea scallop, these are bay scallops, both eggs and sperm are generated in the same individual. And they're not released at exactly the same time, so that they don't fertilize their own eggs, but they are still going to spawn within a few hours, assuming that the animal's in nature. The eggs are going to go off, and the sperm will then encounter other eggs from some other animal. So then what? We spent 6 weeks getting these guys warm, fat, and happy. What we've all been waiting for. It's sex. And I can remember the very most, as a freshman in high school, having the teacher say, okay, tomorrow we're going to talk about what you always wanted to know about. And the definition is really pretty simple. It's the union of two gametes in order to produce a zygote. And the two gametes, of course, would be the eggs and the sperm. And the zygote is going to be the first stages of the developmental process. Most shellfish are separate. I just mentioned that the scallops they're not hermaphroditic. They are hermaphroditic, but they're not functionally hermaphroditic. So they produce both eggs and sperm in the same animal. And a microscopic exam can be accomplished by either prying the shell open a little bit and taking a tissue sample, or drilling down through the shell and taking the tissue sample. Most likely, or most often, it's just wait until the animal spawns, and then that will define whether it's a male or a female. So a bunch of ifs. If we've spent the 6 or 8 weeks getting the animals warm, happy with food, ready to go, and if they are right, in other words, if they've developed their gametes, and if the triggering conditions are correct. In other words, the temperature has changed enough. In nature, typically they wait for an abrupt change in the temperature. 5, 6, 7 degrees Fahrenheit, or maybe even more than that. And what that represents is a change in time, basically, or a change in conditions where sun has been out all afternoon, for instance, it warmed up the tidal flats, tide comes in, that then warms up the seawater and it flows over the bed of shellfish. If we're thinking about oysters in an estuarine situation, the water of the river is going out and it stays a constant temperature, and then all of a sudden the tide changes and it comes back in again, it's going to be warmer. That is a trigger mechanism for shellfish that they then say, well, they don't really say it, but they recognize that it's time. Why is it time? Because if this spawning event is happening and the tide is carrying the gametes away, they will carry the gametes from all of the other spawning individuals in the same area, and the fertilization will be more likely to be successful. (Clears throat) It's called broadcast spanning, spotting rather, and basically that's what they're doing. They're just broadcasting them out into the water and letting the seawater mix them up and provide the fertilization. Stories abound, and I have never seen it, of spawning events in some of the estuarine areas, in particular in the Chesapeake, where the river literally would turn white as all of the animals spawned at the same time. And the combined gametes just traveled upriver, fertilized, started their journey of life. Some folks have seen that kind of event out in the marsh system, especially in these little holes where there's a bunch of shellfish and all of a sudden the tide comes in or changes and one of the animals spawns and everybody spawns at the same time. So this area represents the adults, and again, we don't know that they're really male and female until such time as they spawn. This section represents what happens when the eggs are fertilized and they become larval stages, tiny, tiny. Then after a few days, a week, 10 days, something like that, they start to change, they metamorphose, just like a caterpillar turning into a butterfly. And then finally we end up as early stages of adults, and finally the adults themselves. Again, fluctuating temperatures, enough food in nature, and exposure during the tidal cycles to make the temperature change, that's what it would be like in June or July if you were an oyster sitting out on the flats. Replicating that in a hatchery, we have the broodstock. We do try and keep it diversified, and we typically with a spawn, the success ratio is 30% maybe of the group that you had been conditioned on a given day. Again, like anything else, some of them develop more rapidly than others. So after 6 weeks, a certain group of the population might be all ready to spawn, but some of the others aren't about to, and they won't. You can change the temperature all you want. You can go up, go down, and they're not going to spawn. So a group will spawn, and you have to hope that that's going to be enough for what you need to collect. The gametes are spawned directly into the water. And that can be done either in a big table, a pool if you want, or individually in very highly sophisticated glass baking dishes. And then from that point, then it's a matter of taking care of them and addressing their needs, which are basically the same as all the other needs: food, temperature, salinity, and clean water. So the day before, the animals have to be scrubbed, because there's lots of different fouling organisms that are going to be hitchhikers on the shell, and they proceed the same way that the shellfish do in terms of getting ready to spawn. That's their life's goal. Little tiny worms or amphipods or whatever are feeding on the same food that you're giving the shellfish. They're warming up as you warm the temperature, and with a temperature shock, they will very likely spawn. But we don't want to culture worms. You want to culture shellfish. Yeah, question in the back.
Just a question. You mentioned salinity on the spawn. Is that one of the trigger mechanisms, salinity for spawning, or is it?
It's a lot less than the temperature is. Okay. Yeah, probably in an estuarine environment, it probably does have an effect. But generally speaking, in hatcheries, it's simply the temperature that will trigger the spawn event. You know? And for the most part, the salinity isn't that critical. Typically 30 parts per thousand, one way or the other, four or five, one way or the other, is probably going to be adequate for most of the species that we're working with. Yeah. So getting rid of the outside is a physical process. Scrub it up, dip it in either dilute bleach or betadine or something to make sure that any of the fouling organisms are dead. Some of the animals like to be put in the refrigerator the night before, believe it or not. I mean, that really gives you a temperature shot, oysters in particular. Again, the bigger temperature range that you can provide, the more likely it is that the spawning is going to happen. We have mechanical stimulation or chemical as well as the temperature shock. Our experience with razor clams was pretty bizarre. Put a dozen or 15 razor clams in a 10-quart pail and just shake the daylights out of it. That was it. put them in a table of water, and within a half an hour, the ones that are ready to spawn are gonna spawn. Bizarre. Serotonin or Valerian can be used. I've never had experience with that. Typically, if you need to get to that stage, they're really probably not that ripe and not ready to spawn. Stripping is a method which can be done as kind of a last resort, and that literally is doing a dissection on the shellfish and stripping the eggs out of the gonads and putting them in water with the spawn, with the sperm rather. Starting the method with some sperm that's in solution might well trigger a group of shellfish thinking that it was another male that started the spawning, and typically the males will begin the whole process. Not necessarily. Down East Maine and Beale Island Hatchery had something that they swore by, and that was a bottle of Moxie on the table. Candlelight, soft music, all of those. In the East Ham Aquaculture Center, we had a very interesting method of spawning soft-shell clams, and that was to put them through a series of temperature up fluctuations by 5 or 6 degrees Celsius over the course of a day. Start at 8 o'clock in the morning, work until 5 o'clock at night. 99% of the time they just sit there and look at you. Okay, fine. Take them out, put them back in the container that they eventually would be living in again, and go home. And come back at midnight and they all spawned. I have no idea why, but they just decided that that was the way they were gonna do it, and so that was the method that worked for us. So here's our high-tech bread baking trays, pans. And in this case, each animal is in an isolated container with seawater, filtered seawater. And this is in a seawater bath. And the whole bath has changed temperature up and down at the same time. Why would you do that? Well, that isolates the eggs or the sperm entirely, and you can then perform any kind of work that you want to do to make sure that that one animal is the only one that you're going to be producing eggs or larvae from. For whatever reason you'd be doing it. It might be large size, it could be shell shape or form or something like that. Base scallops to a lesser degree, I think those are base scallops, two or three in a container. Frequently, if one starts to spawn, the other would be removed, and then you would have an isolated group. The so-called dirty spawn is where a half a bushel is put on the table at the same time. They all spawn, and it really doesn't matter what gets fertilized and what doesn't. This is a little video that I'm hoping is going to work that shows a sea clam. Ah, look at that. And that's the spawning action, and you can see the sperm. Oh, that's probably eggs. And that will continue for 10 or 15 minutes. Maybe not. May stop for a minute and then pick up again. And that is what happens in nature. Again, all at the same time. And in the hatchery, that will then cloud that in the container of water and would represent 6, 10, 12, 15 million eggs. And from there, you can add sperm, and they'll be fertilized, and they'll be starting on their way. Oysters, typically spawning inside containers in a very large container of water, and you can see the coloration is starting to happen. This would be a dirty spawn. So the other one would be an individual. So we started, we had the spawning, and now we're getting into their next stage of life. This would be an egg all by itself, and this would be fertilized with a couple of cell divisions and a couple more cell divisions, and they will develop fairly rapidly. That was photo was probably taken within an hour of the spawning event and the mixing of the sperm and the eggs together. They are then called larvae, and the larvae need, again, temperatures, no other hitchhikers in the water, keeping the system clean, and that includes bacterial hitchhikers. So the filtration that goes into this water is pretty extensive. There are lots of variants on that. Some hatcheries like ultraviolet light in order to make sure that the water is absolutely crystal clear. Many of the hatcheries have found that there are certain organisms that are still beneficial, so like abiotics, that will help the animals to grow, so getting it really sterile is probably not the best idea. They need food on a regular basis. And again, as they grow larger, they need more food, but in the initial stages, a little bit of food. Again, same kind of phytoplankton that we've been growing to get the adults conditioned will be used for the juveniles, perhaps a different species, perhaps the same species. A couple of weeks, maybe sometimes 3 weeks, depending on the species, they will continue to develop and then metamorphose at the end of that time and go from free swimming to a stuck on the bottom kind of animal. The drain down is a phenomenon that happens. These containers that they will be growing in are typically on the order of 100 gallons of seawater. They have a conical shape at the bottom, so there's no corners that the larvae can get stuck in. There's air bubbling all the time so that they're continuously transported through the water column. The food is added typically once or twice a day. There are some systems where it's metered through the course of the day. And the drain down means that you clean out all of the water, dump all the water, you save the larval stages so you don't throw the babies out with the bath water, and then you refill it with clean water again and wash down the larvae during the process. So this would be one of those conical containers. Barely see the cone shape, but the same food that was used earlier is going to be just literally dumped into the top of this container. There's a cover, again, to keep the dust and the other contaminants out. The drain down happens very unceremoniously through a hose into a piece of screening that's glued to a large piece of PVC pipe. Typically a couple of hundred microns, again, depending on the age of the animal, they're going to get bigger. So you start out with a 60 micron, for instance, and end up with a 250. Yes, sir?
Yeah. What age do they have to be that you could actually catch them in that type of
situation? The very first day you would see something like this.
Really?
Yeah. But remember, we're talking 20 million, 40 micron size eggs. As they grow older, if all of them survive, that will be even more dense and more populated through the course of the 10 days that they're living in the conical container. But they need to be captured every single time. Subsequent to that, you'll see that there are a variety of sizes of that mesh. And again, like anything else, humans included, some are fast growers, some are not. And the idea is to make sure that the same size animals are growing together all the time. This is a fundamental concept that will go through the entire process until you harvest them and bring them to market. Same size animals grow better with the same size animals. Small ones will get outcompeted by large ones. So we will do a series of these screens or sieves in the drain downs with the larger screen on the top and then the smaller ones down below it, and perhaps be separated into different larval tanks as the course of the development continues, so that the ones that are, and they could be as much as twice as big as the big ones, could be twice as big as the small ones. The process is simply rinse it down, drain it, wash it off, and then dump this group of animals back into the next tank that's been already filled with clean seawater, it's been warmed to the correct temperature, and aerated. And that typically happens every other day. You don't have to do it every day. This is what the larvae look like after about a week. They actually have a shell. We're looking through the shell, though. It's that thin. This is their gut, and the food that they're eating is the coloration that you see in there. There's the beginnings of some of the muscles that would hold the shells together, and some other characteristics that are not exactly easy to tell, but they are. And there are two shells there, and they will be snapping and moving around by the velum, which is their swimming organ. They are called veligers, and that derives from the Latin. And at the end of it is a bunch of cilia that are pushing like little cores, if you will, and driving them through the water. And early on, they bump into the food particles and digest them simply because their esophagus happens to hit them. As they get a little older, this velum will actually pull the food in and send it into the gut, and that's how they feed. This is a good example of oyster larvae, and you can see the outline of the velum as they're swimming around and propelling themselves through. And some of them are taking a rest. They're just sitting on the bottom and waiting for some initiative to get up and going again. They tend not to like have a bright light on the microscope table, so that a lot of them will slow down. How much? Well, there's a scientist at Milford Aquaculture Center in the National Fisheries Lab. His name is Dr. Wickfors, and he has specialized his entire career on the algae that are fed to juvenile shellfish. And his law, and he actually conducts courses for people that are interested in hatchery operations. And you need to answer three questions: how much, how often, and what species, what type. And he has developed lots of protocols. Again, they're not gold standards. They're subject to lots of different variants, but those are the basics. How big is your culture vessel? How dense is the algae? You know, sometimes your algae will get very, very dense because there's a lot of light and the nutrients are just right. But you need to know how many cells are you feeding them, and you can do that with very basic counting techniques. How many larvae are in there eating this food, and what the species of algae that you've got will vary how much food they need. So the next stage is going from the swimming stage to setting, metamorphosis, becoming a fixed animal rather than a swimming animal. And in nature, they settle to the bottom, and they will do the same thing in a hatchery situation, and they stop swimming. With an oyster, they actually literally will glue themselves to a surface. Typically, it's something that's got calcium carbonate shell, which then translates to another oyster, if it happens to be in the same area. Softshell clams, quahogs, will find a grain of sand, and they'll attach to it with a byssal thread, just like mussels have byssal threads. This is a very preliminary thread attachment. They use it as a mooring. And they just kind of hang out, and they sample the temperature and the salinity and the food. And if they're happy with it, then that byssal thread disappears, the digging foot emerges, and they burrow down into the sand. If it's not, they have the ability to cut the byssal thread and start swimming again. So they have this sort of adolescent, I want to swim, now I want to dig, now I want to swim, now I want to dig. And they finally figure out who I am and why is the sky blue and which way is up, and that's it, that's where they stay. That can extend for a couple, 3 weeks in nature. Take advantage of that in the hatchery and provide all of the right conditions so that when they do settle, finally decide it's time to settle down, they don't continue that process. They actually start digging or lose the byssal thread and become diggers. When you're in the hatchery and you have a bunch of larvae, to decide when that moment is coming is to look at competent larvae. So in oysters, there's a very characteristic dot that shows up in the microscope view, and it's called an eye, and it's not really an eye, but it's sort of photosensitive, and the foot extended, that says, yep, I'm ready. Typically, not unlike the spawning event, when larvae are ready to set, they are looking for the presence of adults, and they have the ability to detect a pheromone, which is secreted by other adults, which is a signal, among other things. The food is good, the water temperature is good, the salinity is good, and there's a presence of other oysters around here. Must be a good place to stop. And that will actually make them settle. And when you're out on the flats digging quahogs, for instance, but a lot of times you'll find a chowder quahog sitting there, and as you dig around it, you'll find three or four little necks. Have you ever had that experience? That's called gregarious setting. Those little necks were swimming along, they got the signal that there's an adult here, and they said, boom, this is home, and they settled right in the same neighborhood. I don't think they really had any conversation about it, but that's what happens. So in the laboratory, you can do the same thing, and you can make that happen by putting a couple of adults in the same place as you had a whole bunch of the larvae ready to set. By that I mean a couple of adults in a tank of water with a million seed will likely trigger them to settle down. Again, temperature changes. With the oysters, remember I said you sometimes put the adults in the refrigerator the night before? Believe it or not, you can take oyster larvae that are eyed, that have the ability to, they're signaling that they're ready to set, wrap them in a paper towel that's wet, throw them in the refrigerator, get it down to 10 degrees C. Pick them out the next morning, put them back in seawater, they're gonna set much, much more frequently than if they just came out of the warm water and then tried to set them in warm water. Again, that's one of those little tricks of the trade. There's no standard for it, it happens. Again, presence of adults. And in oysters, this notion that they need to attach to something that is calcareous can be done by either ground up eggshell, which is a lot easier to grind up than an oyster shell, or some other kind of micro culch. Now the word culch is used as something that's a shell-like material that the juveniles are gonna attach to. The odd word, but it's commonly used. And then the other word that shows up shortly after that is the baby that has attached to that is referred to as spat, S-P-A-T. Again, light and dark. If the eyed larvae, so-called, recognize that there's not much light around, they're a little more likely to settle. And typically in nature, you'll find oysters that are settled underneath some object rather than out on top exposed to the direct sunlight. And again, that's probably a defense mechanism so that they don't get eaten by something that's crawling around on the top. The predator would have to look around on the bottom side in order to get their meal. A couple of other photomicrographs of different stages. This is the velum, the swimming characteristic. This is a digging foot on, and the velum out. And this is an example of the velum and the digging foot in, looks like a soft shell clam. And again, it's 0.05 millimeters. That's a line drawing that shows us what the velum looks like and all of the different parts of the individual. Very, very similar to the adults that we talked about last week. It's got musculature for closing the shell and opening it, muscles for sending the leg, the foot out and back again. Very crude stomach, and the gills are beginning to show up in here, digestive gland and intestine. So they're miniature versions, and will develop into the adults. There's a better photomicrograph of both the velum and the foot. And the eye spots are not easy to distinguish once you get used to looking at them. That would be the little dot, and it's typically in the middle of the shell, but depending on the orientation of it. And when you see the majority of the larvae with those eye spots, then you know it's time they're going to set. So instead of putting them back into the larval the conical container, it's time to put them in with some shell fragments someplace. Clams doing the same thing. Got a few feet out here. All right, there we go. Now, in the hatchery, the setting system is, again, replicating nature. We're trying to get some kind of shell fragments. That would be in the bottom of that screen. Again, that's just a piece of PVC with the fine mesh glued to the bottom of it. It's immersed in a larger tank of temperature-controlled water. And the air, use airlift flows to exchange the water from this big tank into and through the inside of that screen that has the shell fragments, and that is where the baby oysters, the eyed larvae that are ready to set, would be dumped unceremoniously in a beaker. It's time. And then, again, the water would be exchanged every other day, the food would be added, the temperature is regulated, and the aeration keeps the oxygen at appropriate levels. Different kinds of downwellers, different ways to accomplish that, but essentially airlifts are very, very gentle, no moving cranks, no fouling, low cost of operation, and the water either comes up from the bottom and out through this discharge side, and the airlift is helping in here, or the water is brought up the airlift tube here and dropped down into this container, and it flows past. But the point is the shellfish stay on the screen, and the screen allows the water to pass through into the surrounding tank. The material could be all-purpose, it could be in scallops, has to be just something that's got a lot of strings. They like to attach in nature to things like eelgrass blades and that sort of thing. But you could certainly put in anything that's fuzzy, like a ragmark kind of material, and they would set on that. Sea scallops like to settle on larger grains of sand or cobble. Coags and steamers could set on mud or steam, or sand rather, or just plain plastic. They're perfectly happy attaching to the Nitex, the screening material. Oysters do need something that's hard. They need something that's got calcium in it. And once they're ready with that signal that we have the eyes and it's time to go, they will set to the inside of the tank if you're not careful. And we just went backwards. Previous. Previous again. All right, that's what happens at the end of the, okay. As a test pattern, again, something that's calcareous would be a tile from a bathroom or a kitchen installation. It has a lot of calcium carbonate in it, and they will very readily attach to it. It's a nice standard because you know the size of it, and you can immerse these with your eyed larvae that are ready to set, and then after a period of time pick it out and count how many did set on that particular square measurement of surface area. Will give you an idea what the overall setting for the batch was. So here we're talking about 1, 2, 3. These are glue tabs that are not, don't count for oysters. That gives you then a handle on what the success ratio was. 10 or 15% is not a bad estimate for eyed larvae setting and actually surviving the setting experience. 50%, 40% is not a bad ratio for fertilized eggs to eyed larvae. So the numbers diminish fairly quickly in a hatchery. They're still not 20 million to two, but they're not 100% either. So the business plan for the hatchery has to estimate how many spawns is it going to take and how many eggs need to be fertilized all at one time in order to produce the number of seed that I have promised my customers. Then this is what the seed is going to look like when it comes out of the nursery and goes to you for your grow out. They're still pretty small, and that's what we're going to be talking about in after our break is how do we handle it. So it's time to stretch. I think there's some coffee in the back. Questions? Yeah.
Hi, Megan. So the oyster seed has to set or it will die. That's part of its. Even though a microculture it has to do that, you just can't get your singles without it.
Yeah, if it doesn't glue to something, it will expire. Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Does the in regards to the taste of the oyster, does the where you get the seed determine how the oyster will taste once it's harvested, or is that based on the law?
Yeah, most of that is going to actually depend on where it grows up, and the algae that's growing as an adult. To some extent, the sediment that's in the area, a lot of iron might change that, or less iron, something like that.
So not much influence, whether a hot seed there or...
Yeah, no, there isn't any selection in the rootstock for any particular flavor. Great, okay, stretch. All right, choosing a seed supplier. Now you know all about how to build a hatchery if you want to. You're gonna be buying from one of these companies that does this work. What you want to think about is what their facility is. Is it a real hatchery? Are you buying it from somebody that's actually buying it from a hatchery and then processing it a little bit, growing it up to a bigger size? We can go through something called an upweller in order to contain the animals, give them natural food in a slightly artificial situation, where you can take the seed and plant it directly in the field. You need to know what the costs are going to be for all of those things, what the legal limitations might be depending on what your license site allows you to do, and things like the disease history, if the word is out that a particular hatchery or seed supplier has lost an awful lot of animals due to disease, then the suggestion might be that they're not all that careful about their methodologies, and the old white line warranty, cross that white line, then you're on your own kind of thing. You need to have some expectation that your supplier is going to stand by the product and that you're not going to be left with a whole bunch of tiny ashtrays. And how are they producing what they're giving to you? In other words, do they sell the biggest, fastest growers to some other client and give you the stuff that's never going to grow anyway or has been growing much more slowly? Those kinds of things you're going to need to learn about and to make your decision based on that information. We have lots of different facilities. This is a municipal facility where the town has put together a downwelling, upwelling arrangement to buy tiny seed and grow it up to broadcast it. We have an upweller that's floating in a harbor and uses a pump to drive water through it. This is a field grow out arrangement where the seed is put directly out there. And this is a facility that's on shore that has pumps and will actually grow the nursery stage on shore. So a hatchery all by itself would be doing the spawning and the larvae culture. The upwellers, as I said, could be land-based or floating. The seed come from someplace and go into the upweller. And then the field nursery is just put out in the field. And they could be your field nursery or could be somebody else's field nursery that they would then sell you the seed after it's gotten to a larger size. So the basics are, the smaller the seed that you buy, the less expensive it is. The bigger that you buy it at, the more expensive. Stands to reason, time is money. If you're buying bigger seed, you're getting a jump start on the season. The animals are gonna grow to a larger size in a fixed period of time than if you bought tiny seed. But it's more dollars out of your pocket at the outset. You've gotta balance that in your business plan and see what works for you. Generally speaking, most hatcheries, most nurseries sell seed in a cost per thousand animals. And everything that's done in the aquaculture industry is by piece. It's not volumetric, it's not bushels, it's not pounds, it's by the piece. So you start out buying it by the piece. $10 a thousand means a penny per seed shellfish. And it goes up from there. Again, best management practices. The BMP demands diligence for you as well as for the hatcheries, as well as for the nurseries growers. Seed sources have to be state approved. The Commonwealth Division of Marine Fisheries samples all of the product that comes out of, not all of the product, but representative product that comes out of each of the hatcheries for disease and for genetic composition. In other words, they don't want to see any invasive species being produced in the hatchery. It happens. there's cross-contamination, if you will, and sometimes there will be some species that aren't supposed to be there. But if they pass all of the tests, then the division will list them on a page that said this is an approved source and you may buy your seed from that approved source. The disease certification is generally done with a microscopic examination of representative animals, and they actually look for the disease with thin section microscopic slides. So it's very exhaustive and it's pretty comprehensive. And currently, because of the way some of these diseases are progressing, in warmer waters, the diseases are more prevalent, so Commonwealth only permits seed to be purchased from New York or north, so that would be down east. And then the town of Duxbury has some additional limitations, which are unique to that town. There is a list of approved hatcheries that you can find at this URL, or you can Google Mass Approved Shellfish Hatcheries and it'll bring you to that. It said last year there were 20, and the process continues through this time of year up until about May or June, by the time all of the hatcheries and nurseries get their samples through the process. It can be a little bit time consuming, so, and then some of the hatcheries have a good history, it's consistently good, that they will be certified earlier, others probably not so much. So your questions that you want to ask are, do they have, is there a location someplace where we know that there's some kind of disease issue? And as introductory growers, you're not going to know that. But the way to find out is to ask around. So when you're in your town, and you're working with your constable or your fellow growers, strike up a conversation and find out what suppliers of seed they have used, what their experiences have been. Listen a lot and ask good questions and write it down and then make your decisions based on the best available information. Are the seeds selected for fast growth? In other words, are you going to get the slow growers that the nursery grower or the hatchery deliberately held back? And when they did that culling, there are groups in any group of spawning animals that are going to be faster growers and slower growers, or is it a mix? And when you get a particular size group of seed, are they pretty much all the same size? Or were they a little bit negligent or sloppy about making sure that the same size went together? Are you going to pick it up locally? Or does it have to come from afar? If it does, how is it going to be shipped? How is it going to stay fresh and cool, not too cold? What are the methods that they use to ensure that you're going to get it? And some hatcheries will put it on a small aircraft and fly it to an airport near you. Some of them will do FedEx overnight delivery. Pack it well, put a lot of ice packets, but not too close to the shellfish, but make sure that the temperature is somewhere where it wants to be. A hatchery that just throws it in a baggie, it says it's on the back porch, pick it up when you get by, is not going to be the kind of outfit that you want to work with, because you're going to have instant shells. Do you ask around again? If somebody had a problem, how did the nursery hatchery handle the problem? What was the deal? Now, granted, there's always two sides to a story, so it could have been a disaster to start with, but as you ask around, you're going to get a little profile that you want to think about. And then if the price is almost next to nothing, that's probably what you're going to get for your money. It could be on the way out, a disease problem that they're not telling about or something like that. Your good money will go to waste. So know your supplier. Make sure they're on the supplier list, because if they're not, you're in violation. Do we know about the disease history? Do you get good recommendations? There aren't too many Yelp recommendations on shellfish seed hatcheries, but you can do the same kind of thing, crowdsourcing your information with your fellow growers. Was it on time? If they promised it the second or third week in May, and it showed up the second or third week in June, that's going to upset your plan. things happen. So you can't have one instance define how a hatchery does its business, but over a period of years, the better suppliers are going to be more consistent with their timing. Was it counting accurate? We're going to be talking about that. How do you know you get this big batch of double handful of seed, how many you've got? If it wasn't accurate, how did they resolve the dispute? And then make sure that you understand that not everybody is going to be straightforward with their responses too. So, when the hatchery spawned the animals, were they spawned in January and they're still really tiny and it's now June? Or if they're just 6 weeks or 8 weeks old and they're pretty good size, that tells you that they're fast growing. If they were spawned last July and they were grown through the course of the summer and then overwintered and you're buying them 1st of April, for instance, at a little bit bigger size, it's good to know that they did make it through the winter, but were they handled properly through the winter? Were they stressed during the winter? How many different groups of animals is the hatchery working with at the same time? In other words, are they a big powerhouse that has lots going on all the time, or is it just one single spawn that happened to survive and that's what you're buying? And how many culls? How many times did they separate out the slow growers, the runts? Some of that information they're not going to want to share with you, especially if you're a first-time buyer. But as you get more experience with it, those are the kinds of questions that you'll be able to ask. How many sivings went through? How many did they combine groups? Did they commingle different spawns to get the same size, a uniform size of what you're buying? If you've got the slow growers from one spawn that are at 2 millimeters and the fast growers from a later spawn that are 2 millimeters, when you have them out in your site, there's going to be lots of fast growers and lots of slow growers, and that's not what you want. You want everybody growing at about the same rate. You may not get that information, but after you've had some experience, you'll be able to hear about it. Okay, you don't have any movies. We already had one of those. So what do we do when we take the delivery seed? Well, again, we find out how they're going to deliver it to you. Will you inspect it? You're going to know what you're looking at and what you want to ask for. How you count it, and what you do with it from when you take delivery and sign on the dotted line to when you actually have it in the water and starting to grow on your site. Or if you're going to put it in an upweller, this is probably not common. How is that handled and what's it going to be? How is it going to be handled when you have it? Or if you go straight to a field nursery, there are slight differences between a clam and an oyster field nursery. So when you pick it up, if you pick it up, you want to bring a cooler and some ice packs, and you want to have all your permits in hand. And remember, the Commonwealth has a possession law for seed shellfish. In other words, if it's not the minimum size and you are in possession of it, you are presumed guilty of violating Chapter 130. You can have all the stories in the world about, my friend brought it over and dropped it on the kitchen table, or a bird dropped it as it was going by, or whatever, it doesn't matter. If it's in your possession, then you are responsible for it. What that means is you have to have applied for your permits that allow for you to pick up or to handle X number of oyster seed on or about the 15th of May from a particular supplier and bring it to your aquaculture lease site. It's fairly tightly controlled. What are the odds that you're going to be stopped by the EPOs? Probably not real high, but you need to be in compliance, because if you are stopped, it's the end of the ballgame. And then the seed's going to be taken away from you, and then you go through the process of trying to get that back again. Some will actually deliver, as I said, next day air, something like that. Some will drive to your site and hand you the styrofoam box with the seed in it. It varies. Find out what it's going to be before you actually make your decision. If they are shipped overnight, they definitely have to be kept cool with cool packs, and if this happens, it won't happen in the middle of summer, but if you have a hot day in June or May, it could be a real stress for the animals. And this is when you want to start keeping good records. This is the beginning of the trail, the paper trail, to make sure that you know what's going on. And you can go back and say, okay, last year it worked this way and that was good, or that way it really wasn't great, so I'm not gonna bring that cooler, I'm gonna bring the other cooler, and I'm gonna have twice as much ice packs or whatever it is. Take notes, write down numbers, dates, times, anything that's gonna help your memory come back when you go to look at it in the future. Catchphrase for me is write it down or write it off, because it's gone if it's not on a piece of paper. Are they damp? They want to be slightly wet. They don't want to be sopping wet. They don't want to be in water, because they'll try and pump. And that water that they're in is probably melt water from ice, which is fresh water, and that will kill them. Are they cool? Throw a thermometer in the batch of the seed and see what the temperature is. Somewhere around 60 is probably good. Use your nose. If it doesn't smell good, there's something that doesn't smell good. It could be something else. It could be some other biofouling that was in the hatchery, the nursery, algae or something, but it's a signal. Pay close attention. Shells are going to be close together, shut, if these are healthy animals. If they're gapped open and they've only been out of the water for a couple of hours, that's not a good sign. Is the container in good shape? This container had a little bit of a problem. Something leaked, and it could have been the ice particles packed, or it could have been the ice itself. It could have been banged up. That was probably an overnight delivery. Immediately let your supplier know, just like a UPS delivery. That could be the size of the seed that you purchase. That's pretty tiny stuff. That's about 3, 4, or 5 millimeters. Look at them carefully. You don't need a microscope, but are they alive? If it's small, you can actually crush them with your fingernail and see if there's really meat inside, because sometimes two shells stuck together could be two dead shells stuck together. You want to see some tissue in there. A magnifying glass might help. Put a couple of dozen in some seawater and see if they start opening on their own and pumping. If they're in good condition, that should happen within 5 minutes or so. There can be dead seed in your shipment, but if the supplier knows that 5% is dead, then they should give you 5% more on the count to make up for that. But if they tell you that everything in this shipment is alive, and you're finding that 5% is dead, that's not exactly an arm's length transaction. And what you want to do about it is can probably depend on a lot of other things. But. So how do you count a double handful of things that are that size? Well, there's lots of different ways. And you will pick one that works for you. It's important to do that, especially the very first times that you pick up seed, but every time it is, because you need to be confident that this person or this company that you purchase seed from is in fact treating you as a valued customer, and is giving you what you expected and what you ordered and what you're paying for. You can weigh them, you can split them, and that is dividing. You can do a wet pack volume or a volumetric displacement. And basically, you don't have to count them all. So if you ordered 50,000, you don't have to worry about 1, 2, 3. You do a small subset, and then you do the math. And you can do a couple, 3 small subsets and average those numbers, and that'll get you pretty close. We're not talking about infinitely precise numbers. So if you ordered 50,000 and you got 49,962, close enough. If you got 20,000, then it's time for a phone call. If they're not all the same size, that's going to be another problem. But we already said that's going to be a problem for you down the road anyway. Getting a little better at that. Weighing. So we use a little scale. You can use a postal scale or something like that. You take a portion, you weigh that, and you pick the weight of the whole thing, and then you count that subset accurately, and that will take a little bit of time. You've got some time, and it's not imperative that they go into the water within 5 minutes of your handling them. But you don't want to do it in the bright sunshine or on a dry, sunny day. You want to take care of the animals. So come indoors, find a place that's cool, and make yourself comfortable and do an accurate count. And the basic formula is the total weight over the sample weight times how many will give you the number that was shipped. So So for example, and this is in your handout, so you can go through it at home. If you had a 5-pound shipment and you took a bunch out and it weighed 3 ounces, do the math, that's 0.1875 pounds. And you count that sample, and there's 480 in it, and you do the math, 5 pounds over 0.1875 times 480 means that you actually received 12,800. Most of the suppliers will actually give you a printout of how they calculated what you are buying. And they will do it one of the 4 methods, and they will come up with some number that's somewhere around the number that you've got, we hope. Is it a good number? That's your evaluation. Splitting. So you take the container, and you roughly eyeball it and put it into 2 containers that are about the same size. And you take one of those and you do that again, you split it again. So now you have a quarter of the group. Keep going down through the tree until you get down to some number that you're comfortable with where one of these little bunches is countable. Could be another 500 roughly. Therefore, if you count 256 in one of these little blocks and you do the math, that's 1/64th of the total, then you would get 16,384. And that's not a precise number either, but if you ordered 15,000 and that's the number that you came up with, you'd be happy. That's pretty close to 15. If you ordered 20,000 and that's the number you came up with, you might count a couple more and see if it comes closer to 20 on some of the others. A wet pack is using a graduated cylinder, and you can purchase those. There's a couple of suppliers that did agriculture equipment in Florida that has all kinds of stuff like this, all the way from very scientific stuff to pumps and everything else. It'll come to me. I'm sorry? Aquatic ecosystems. Thank you, Dan. You add some water to some sample line. You add some of the seed, and you tap them down. And then, excuse me, you dump them out and you count them and get all of these averages and divide those counts by the sample size. And so you fill up the graduated cylinder to 5 milliliters and you count that group of 5 milliliters 3 different times. You average it and you come out with 85. So there are 85 in 5 mils. Therefore, there are 17 per mil. And then in a larger container, you do that, all of the seed on another larger graduated cylinder or something that has milliliters on the side of it. You put all of the seed in there, and you find that it's actually 4,000 milliliters for the entire shipment. And then you do the math, and 17 times 4,000 would be 68,000 in the total batch. If you ordered 70,000, that's close. If you ordered 50,000, that's a bonus. Numbers have probably come pretty close. Is it a good number? You've got to ask yourself that. Okay, volumetric displacement is slightly different variant on the theme. So you fill it to a known position of water, and then you add a fixed number of animals. So you count out, for instance, 100. And as it's the old story of the crow and the stone and the glass of water, as you add the seed into this tube of water, the level is going to go up because it's going to displace the water. And the difference in volume will be the displacement of the seed that it counted. So you start out with 28 mils of water has been displaced, and you knew that you put 100 clams in, that's 0.28 per clam. Do that all over again with the big batch the same way that you did with the dry, and then check to see how much water was displaced when you put the 2,000 in, and it goes up to 3,150. do the math, and the displaced water is 1,150 milliliters, so that each clam occupies 0.28, and that ends up being the 4,107 count for that particular group, that particular method. If you ordered 5,000, it's a little short. If you ordered 4,000, it's okay. Typically, these are sold with an R number, which corresponds to the size of the sieve that they were screened on. In other words, the bigger screen is at the top, as we started talking about earlier. Smaller screens go down to the bottom. And so the bigger R number is going to be the top screen, and the smaller ones will be below that. And the R number would be, no, we don't have R on this table. But if you were to buy them at 2 millimeters, it would be a number 10 sieve size. They'd be approximately 3 millimeters in width. Remember we said the length was from the hinge out, but the width is down the other way. Corresponds to about 80 days old since it was spawned. So that should give you some idea of when the spawning happened, depending on what size you're buying. If you're buying seed in this range, it's probably in the order of $10 per thousand, give or take. If you buy it up at this size, it's probably double that, or maybe 2.5 times that. So again, that gives you a sense of the scale. Call around, find out what the price lists are. They publish the price lists, so you'll know exactly what it is that you're going to be getting. Take your time, do the math a couple of times, make sure that you've got it right. If you're not happy with your math, or you lose count, or the phone rings and you drop it and start all again, that's okay. As I said, shellfish are going to be okay for a short period. Well, if they were shipped overnight, they've already been out of water for 24 hours, so that gives you a little sense of urgency. And if there is a phone call, find out what method they used if they didn't tell you when you arrived, when it arrived in your doorstep. But you only have to pay for the live stuff, and that's generally recognized as you don't have to buy dead shells. And the hope is that they recognize that if they did put some shell in there, they accounted for it in their counting method as well. And there'd probably be a note on the side of it. So now what do you do when you got it? Well, you need to have everything set up and ready to go before that day arrives. So all of your gear is ready to go. And the gear, written records, did we say that? Yes, we did. Very important, all of the details. All of these arithmetic calculations that you're doing want to be part of that record. And keep it in a bound book and keep it as dry as you can. But don't fail to write in it every chance you get. So an uproller system would be something that would be at a dock, or if you happen to be really fortunate and you want a question in the rear.
Hi. So if you get your seed like mailed to you and it's in the box and it's like 40 degrees, and it's the middle of summer and the water's like 70 degrees, should you let the temperature of the oysters come up so it doesn't shock them?
Yeah, question is if they arrive at 40 Fahrenheit and the water temperature is 60 or 65, you don't just dump them in the water, and that is correct. You want to warm them gently. Gently means over a period of maybe 2 or 3 hours, not another day and a half for sure, but over a period of time. They're pretty resilient and they can handle that. And typically, it will be the other way around, that they will, if there's a change in temperature, it's more likely that it's a hot day and the ice melted or the ice packs didn't do as good a job, so they might be closer to 70. That's a little bit more of a danger, because they're not going to handle a high temperature as well as they will a cooler temperature than normal, but they can withstand a pretty wide range, but don't shock them. Exactly right. Upweller systems would be either in the building, if you happen to own a building. Anybody own a building with big pumps? No, I don't think so. An upweller system can be a floating arrangement. That's very uncommon also. Municipalities have been doing that. There's a couple of private ones. They're getting into some logistics and permitting issues with that. Field nurseries, if you're going to buy very, very tiny seed, slightly different for both oysters and clams, but it can be done, and again, it's a matter of intervention. How do you protect them against the wilds of nature, the predators that would love to eat them, the sand that would love to smother them, the waves that would love to wash them away? It's your job to intervene and to protect them. And if you have an upweller or a raceway, there's lots of nice things about that. It is very, very high survival. There are no predators. You're not going to get a crab show up in the laboratory. You can walk, keep your shoes on, no boots, and you're dry, and you can do all of your work at home. But they're expensive. They need pumps. They need electricity. You usually need some extra permits. If you can secure the permits, not likely a good option. These are huge arrangements. This happens to be a dock and a marina, and the cover of the dock opens up, and all of the upweller tanks are exposed. A fair amount of maintenance has to go on there because the sun never comes to shine on those to clear out all of the fouling organisms, but it does give you a lot tighter control and a lot better options for how you handle the seed. Typically, most nursery operations aren't going to raise shellfish seed much above about 8 millimeters. It corresponds to roughly 3/8 of an inch, something like that, 5/16. What it does is allow you to buy much smaller seed and then grow them and get them growing early in the summer at a fairly accelerated rate so they get a jump start. But because there are extra costs involved with operating it, then that offsets the cost of the savings of buying the smaller seed. These are a couple that we built in Eastham using the tide to drive water into the scoop at the front end, and it pushed the tide water up through these upwelling boxes and then out through the PVC pipes. It's pretty effective. We could grow 50,000 clams in one of those trays. The downside was what we had them in was a very eutrophic saltwater river. They were anchored on the scoop end, and regardless of which way the tide was going, it would orient itself into the tide, and the water was always pumping. But the fouling was unbelievable, and it took every 3 days, take it all apart, put it back together again. Yeah, question?
Eutrophic?
Very eutrophic. Oh, I'm sorry. Eutrophic means that there's way too much stuff growing there. It is overcome with nutrients, and algae and the fouling organisms are growing faster than the shellfish are. So, yeah.
So that clogged with vegetative matter.
It was vegetative matter. It was also sea squirts. It was bryozoans that were opportunistic, just jumping on it. And there was so much nutrients in that water that everything grew at once. And trying to isolate just the shellfish growing was a major problem.
You don't mind my asking, was that Nauset Marsh?
Yeah, Salt Pond, as you can see it from the visitor center. Yeah,
below the visitor center.
Right. Yep. Beautiful setup, worked out great, but very, very labor intensive. So that offset the cost of the, offset the expense of this.
Well, if you don't have utility, you don't have electric, right? You don't have a pump.
That's right.
Okay.
Yeah. So put them out in the field has great advantage because you don't have a pump, you don't have issues with fouling particularly. The disadvantage is you've got to trudge out on the flats somehow and get to them, and you've got the potential for whatever you've got them in not being effective and predators eating them, birds, whatnot. But and your permit is already set for that particular license site that you're working on. There are environmental hazards. You could have a hurricane, you could have storm situation, you could have a downpour with changing the salinity very quickly with the heavy rains. Not as perfect as a control situation, but still a good alternative if you decide to go with small seed and grow them from an earlier age, an earlier size, a smaller size up. The types are, again, very simple. We've had a couple of discussions about how high-tech this whole industry is. This is it, state of the art. Plastic mesh. And actually, the majority of the suppliers for most of the aquaculture equipment are industries that supplied fencing material They went to vinyl fencing material and the light went off and they said, ah, we have a whole new market here. So they produce this plastic material by the mile and they spin it out on rolls, various size meshes, various gauges of the thickness of the plastic, and you can pick almost any variant on that from the width of the roll to the length of the roll to the size of the plastic and make what you need to intervene for your shellfish in your location at the size that they are growing. So some of them float, some of them are on the bottom, some are kind of a mix of each. You can do a pond or impoundment, but that's a little bit complicated. Simple is better. And if we have the gear out there, what we need to be sure is that the seals, the corners, the edges are tight, because this is designed so that the crabs won't get through. But if you leave an opening someplace, the crabs are out there 24/7. They always bring their appetite with them. They will find that opening. So that you need to be diligent about your intervention. You need to be sure that sediment doesn't filter in there, get washed in there, literally bury the shellfish. May not bury the entire container that they're in, but the shellfish are at the very bottom of that container. They don't swim much, and that could be a problem. We need to identify any predators that might be in there. You've got to visually look at them on a regular basis. Be diligent. What you do is you maximize the growth and survival, and you're able to get the seed from tiny, if you want to go that route, to medium. And then you go from there, just as if you bought medium-sized seed from the nursery or from the hatchery. Small mesh bags are just exactly what they sound like. And you can certainly take a look at how complicated this is. So it looks like an onion bag. It's a little bit finer mesh. And again, using this high technology nomenclature, this is a spat bag, as in the seed settles, and it's called spat. You put the spat in here, it's protected, there's a little drawstring at the top, and the water will flow through this mesh very, very well, as long as it's clean, doesn't have algae growing on it, there's no other fouling organisms. But the mesh is slightly smaller than the animals that you're putting in there, so that they stay in, and the water goes through, and the predators are not able to get inside here either. As a secondary, this mesh bag, this spat bag, would be put inside of another container, and that has a two-edged sword with it too, because this is going to protect against the predators that much better. It's a double layer. It's like having two moats around the castle. But it also provides something for algae or other fouling organisms to grow on. So you're going to have to be doing more cleaning. It's a balance. It's just like owning a boat. There is no boat that is perfect for everybody's needs at all the time. There's a compromise. Might be the right size, but not the right beam. Might be beautifully high gunnels, but probably too heavy to operate if you're rolling by yourself. All of those kinds of considerations. Everything is a balance. And how do you learn what the balance is? By experience, or by asking your neighbors or your fellow growers what works. So you come to a site like this and you ask around what works. This particular one is hung off of a clothesline. You'll probably see those in another week. We have some of the growers that are using these. They float, drifting back and forth like that as the tide comes in and the water swashes back and forth. It changes, exchanges the water very, very quickly, and the shellfish are stuck inside. The predators aren't going to get them. You can divide those up with physical compartments to keep the shellfish from all going to one end or the other. Depending on how busy the waterway is, that may be a problem for you. Once the seed is getting to a larger size, and it's overcrowding this particular size bag, you want to move it out. It's just like thinning the seedlings in a garden. You might plant the seeds very dense initially, and then you pull out every third or every second or every, leave one out of five seedlings once they start to grow. Well, with your oysters, you're not going to take them out and throw them away, but you aren't going to give them more space because they need that water circulation. They need the space and the water flow, so you give them more area in which to do that. This is a good example of the bags on the bottom secured somehow. The wind pushed all of the shellfish to one side, and they're all piled up in there. That's a problem, because you're not going to be out there 24/7 saying, "Wind, stop, would you please go the other way?" You're going to have to count on that happening and perhaps go out there on a regular basis and just physically move the shellfish around in that container and push them so that they all get a shot at equal amounts of water. There's too much competition in here. Question in the back? No? With clams, similar. Again, if you have small seed and you want to protect them from predators and washing away and all of the other things that a good intervention would be a container of some sort. And a couple of different variants on that have come up. 5-gallon pails with the bottom cut out was one option that was used, and we'll hear about that in a couple of weeks. Put a mesh screen around the top of it. Again, as I said, these suppliers make this mesh kind of material in lots of different variants and sizes, and you can buy as much as you want. You can get a piece that will go right over the top of a 5-gallon pail. A bungee cord will hold it on and put some sediment in there, put the baby clams in, and they're very well protected. They still get good water circulation, and they'll grow fairly rapidly. By the same token, it's a fairly small area to work with. Maybe an 18-inch diameter circle. You could put a couple hundred animals in there, and then after they get growing very quickly, you need to take them all out of there. A lot of hand labor. So how much time do you want to spend moving these babies around as they continue to grow? Again, it's all a matter of economics. If you can only afford very small seed, and you have plenty of time to go out day after day after day and work on moving them, that's fine. But if your time is limited, then you may want to think about slightly larger seed where you don't have to handle them quite as many times. So your intervention is provide predator protection, plant at high densities, but watch them carefully because they'll starve to death. Yeah.
What do you consider high densities?
Oh, 50, 75 to a square foot, roughly, would be optimal, let's put it that way. So 200 to a square foot would be way too high. At the end of that growing season, then you can take them out and just field plant them. At the end of the growing season, generally speaking, means that the length of the clam from the hinge to the outer margin is on the order of an inch or better. Much smaller than that, they're basically just ringing the dinner bell for all of the crab predators. If they're at or above an inch, they will probably burrow down quickly enough and deeply enough that the crabs aren't going to get them. Again, your crab, your mileage may vary. You might have a crab population that, you know, somehow or other figured it out, and they'll eat a 2-inch. But generally speaking, that's the magic number from our experience. If you have them smaller than that, they still need to have intervention. They still need to have a net over them. And there are different ways to put those nets out. And again, some folks will plant a very dense, and they call it a run, because it's typically a rectangle that's 50 feet long or thereabouts, and 15 or 12 feet wide. These are the same kinds of things. This sort of a mesh, it's finer mesh, and they use a piece of PVC tubing that's got a slit down the side of it in order to seal the edges. These are the buckets that are an array of again, a couple of hundred per bucket, so that's an awful lot of buckets and a half an acre. Yeah.
Why would they spread the buckets out? Have them spread out so far?
Just to be able to walk around them.
Oh, okay.
So you don't step in them when you're working on the one beside them. Yeah. Thousand to a square foot for, you know, tiny seed is okay. 4 to 6 millimeter at 1,200 to a square foot. But I think that's a little too dense. I'm not sure that I would recommend it that dense. And then once they get to 15 millimeters, they can go out under a net. They need 25 millimeters or about an inch before they can go out without any protection. Again, a millimeter or so, when they first come from the hatchery, they still have that thistle thread. They can all hang together and turn into a clump, which is a good sign because that means they're healthy, but it's a bad sign because that provides like a sail. And the water, the wave action might actually pick that sail up and start floating it away on you. So what are we talking about? We're taking delivery of the seed from your nursery or your hatchery. You want to count it? How did you get what you ordered? How are we going to handle it once we've got it in our possession? Are we going to put it in a nursery arrangement on the flats? Are we going to find some upweller or a building or something like that? We talked about how to handle them, how to protect them, how to intervene with these kinds of high-tech devices. And we're going to be out there looking at them on a regular basis because it's not a set and forget kind of thing. The day that your seed arrives means the beginning of your next career, which is tending to and making sure that things that could go wrong are addressed and they don't go wrong. Crabs don't get inside of these, waves didn't wash it away, or that you accurately nailed down all the corners. Looking inside to make sure that they're still alive. And record keeping, writing it down. Make sure that you've got a record, that you know what happened and when. And if you can, and something went wrong, what went wrong? Why did it go wrong? What can I think of that I wouldn't do next year? Okay, any other questions? Yeah.
Is there any way to profile the nutrients in a specific water site for their suitability as nutrient? Like, for instance, if I were to take a water sample of a specific river, which is eutrophied, and profile that, is there any way to compare that against standard knowledge for its complexion and then its suitability?
Yeah. Yes, there is. However, a snapshot like that is meaningless.
Because you're going to go over the season.
Exactly. And there's such a wide array
of... So there's no commonly accepted, yardstick, say, measure it every 30 days, do BOD and DO, and then do a profile of the nutrients.
That would give you a rough idea. Yep. But there's a lot of variability even with that. And in general, the better indicator is to look around and see if there's any shellfish growing.
Yeah, see what's there.
Yeah, they're going to be your better sentinels and see what kind of growth rates you see and how many rings are in the shells. And
that's a lot of these places have so much black mayonnaise that's...
That is a problem. So, and again, in an aquaculture site, you can only be licensed in a site that's not productive. So that's kind of like catch 22.
Catch 22.
If there's nothing growing around here, you know, how do I know that I could grow stuff? In general, unless you see some really disastrous anoxic conditions, so mayonnaise is a good example of no oxygen, but if you see dead fish there, that's kind of a bad sign. If you see an awful lot of shells that are dead shells in place, something happened there as well. The variability in phytoplankton is going to be huge across even a week or a day's time. Species bloom and crash in a matter of hours in some cases. But in general, most of the places in this area are going to have an adequate supply of phytoplankton. We're dumping so many nutrients into our groundwater and coastal waters that there's plenty of nutrition for the algae to grow. Whether it's a species that is going to be a weed species or a healthy species remains to be determined. But and certain areas even within the same estuary might have different growth rates for the same species of shellfish.
So the only real barometer is trial and error at this point.
Bingo, exactly. Learning by doing. Yeah.
Water quality testing, how does that occur?
Commonwealth designates areas for shellfish harvest based on one criteria, and that is fecal coliform bacteria. And so they are classified as approved, conditionally approved, or prohibited, depending on how many fecal coliform bacteria are there. You can only have an aquaculture site in approved areas. So by definition, you're good to go from the start. And they're all mapped, and you can go online and find out where the approved areas are, and it's not out for sure. There are no regular tests for other water quality parameters that are done by the state. Extension Service does a lot of work in some of the areas. There's an awful lot of data that's available for certain spots, but phytoplankton counts would be part of that. But in general, not really too site specific. Great. Well, next week we're going to be talking about clams and the specifics of how to go about planting them and getting to. So.